Please welcome on stage Stefan Pirnbaum.
Yeah, thank you. So, hi, I'm Stefan. As already told, I'm here from Dresden. I work at Bushmills. We are kind of small IT consulting company dealing with legacy systems, modernizing applications, but also building new systems. Okay, so my presenter's working. That's great. So, I'm Stefan. I'm a personal visually. I speak at the NEOS conference. This is a conference hosted in Dresden, which is a city. I speak about an introduction to Neo4j, which is hosted by NEOSCon, where we are currently. So what we see in just this simple example is that our world is somehow connected. That if it is a person, a conference, a city, or an event or whatever, all these things correlate to each other in some way. So prepare yourself, crafts are coming. Who of you has seen Game of Thrones? Okay, that's expected. So, first off, before I introduce you to Neo4j, I want to settle some basics. Why do we have to use, or why should we use graph databases? What are graph databases? How are the data is modeled, and so on. Later on, I will show you how you can transform from a relational database towards a graph database, and what maybe pitfalls are and so. Okay, so as already mentioned, the world is a graph. The world is full of connected people, of events, other things, and relations between us, between the events, between cities and so on, really matter. Yeah, imagine a world where we are all in, but we have no connection to anyone else. This would be kind of sad. And not only the real world is a graph, but also the IT world is full of graphs. Yeah, think of any software project where, nevertheless, what your language is, you are implementing it. You have modules, packages, classes, and so on. Yeah, modules contain packages, contain classes, classes depend on each other, import each other, and so on. And if you think about our current database design, normally we have relational databases like an Oracle or MySQL or whatever. Where are those joined tables in reality? I mean, if you know your neighbor sitting next to you, is there a joined table between you, or is the relationship directly towards you? Furthermore, besides the relations between data, the data volume is also increasing and is getting much more connected. Think of any area in today's IT world: online transactions, social networks, smart devices. Yeah, your fridge may be connected to your coffee machine, which may be connected to your oven. So your fridge basically knows your oven. I don't know what this brings you, but they know each other, and hopefully they like you. So, as stated, we have a high value in data relationships, and connecting data in a new way can improve existing use cases and can also create new use cases, which thus brings us many advantages over competitors. So data and the relationships between the data really matters today. Especially since the big data movement, which started a few years ago, there is plenty of data which is created every second. Yeah, think about YouTube, think about your smart devices, think about your fridge which reports its temperature. It's every second new data comes in and new connected data is generated. Now model this in a relational database, have fun. So basically, I'm telling you that relational databases are not so relational, which sounds a bit weird because relational databases have the word relational in its name and have proven to be working since many, many years. But still, relational databases can't handle relationships well. They cannot model or store data and relationships without high complexity. Yeah, think of all the join tables you have to implement. Think of all the joins in your SQL queries and so on. Furthermore, the performance degrades with every new join table, with every new level of relationships, and of course with the DB size. Not only the performance decreases, but also the complexity to write those queries increases. So it's much more harder for us as a developer to tackle the current challenges, to connect the data, to make it visible for the user, and so on. And with every new type of data or relationship we introduce, we require basically a schema change, which also needs to be planned and which thus postpones our release. So that's basically why we should at least think about using graph databases instead of relational databases. Now I want to show you some use cases to make it more concrete. I've split it into first the internal applications and the customer facing applications. Yeah, when we have internal applications, think about master data management, or think about network and IT operations, where all my PCs are stored, where we see connections, where we see the routing and so on. Think about fraud detection. And we go to customer facing applications. We of course have real-time recommendations. I don't want to get recommendations from 5 years ago because they are just now computed. I want to get the recommendations which are fitting for me in the current situation. Think about graph-based search, identity and access management, and of course, yeah, maybe a buzzword today, the knowledge graph. If you're interested in these use cases and many more and want to see some specific implementations, you can check the page I linked here. Besides earning money with graph databases, it's also possible to use graph databases for good reasons. You may have heard of the offshore leaks or Panama Papers and Paradise Papers. These are all somehow connected. Panama Papers is the newest one, I guess. For example, the Paradise Papers was a case where 1.4 terabytes of data was leaked, where the data contained 13.4 million records. And this data was stored in a graph database, in the Neo4j graph database. And on this data set, 380 or more than 380 journalists worked together across 67 countries and with 96 media partners to get an idea of what is behind those Paradise Papers. Now, when you get 1.4 terabytes of data, you don't want to start with a schema design, because you even don't know what data is in there. So it needs to be quite flexible. And this is what a graph database can give us. Okay. Then from a medical perspective, maybe two examples. The Caniolo Cancer Institute is doing cancer research. They have highly hierarchical data, which is modeled inside a graph database. Or the German Center for Diabetes Research is also currently using a Neo4j graph database, where we can see, okay, you have your patient data, you have your biobank, you have some general data and so on, and this data is all connected. So I'm talking the whole time about Neo4j. So what is Neo4j? Has someone heard of you from Neo4j? 1, 2, 3, yeah, a few. Have you also worked with Neo4j or just heard about it? So who is currently using it? Okay, maybe this changes after the talk. Okay, so first things first. Neo4j is an asset compliant database. It is transactional, so we don't have to change our mindset about how we handle data. That's good. Neo4j is a native graph database. This is important because there are also non-native graph databases out there. Non-native graph databases store their data most likely in relational databases and make it available using a graph query language, so we don't have the full flexibility, especially when storing the data. Neo4j uses a property graph model to store the data, to organize the data, which I will show you in a few seconds. And there is open source and commercial licensing available. We have high performance and high availability available for the commercial licensing and many more, so depending on your use case. Neo4j also offers drivers for different languages, so for Python, .NET, Java, PHP, JavaScript, R, and maybe even COBOL, I don't know. Would have to check that, but I hope you don't use COBOL anymore. okay, well. Then is a site citation from Werner Voges, he's the CDO of Amazon, which I found during the preparation for this talk. And he said, for anything with multiple relationships, multiple connections, Neo4j absolutely works. And I mean, when the CDO of Amazon, and I guess they have to deal with a high amount of data, which is highly connected, just thinking, then there is some truth in it. Okay, so I already talked about the property graph model, and we now want to dig into it, what it is. In the property graph model, the main idea is that the whiteboard model is the graph model, so that you sit together with your domain experts. They explain what entities they have, so like a company, like employees, and so on, what relationships between them, and he draws it on a whiteboard. When you're coming out from such a meeting, you normally start transforming it into a relational database model. You introduce your join tables and foreign keys and constraints on it, and yeah, kind of some work. And this is also a bit error prone, because you can introduce failures when you transform it, and then the domain expert doesn't understand it anymore because it don't know the notation of such database schemas. So the good part is that we have the same understanding of the data both in the IT and in the business departments. When we model it in our graph database, so this is a snapshot from Neo4j, from the Neo4j browser, you can see, okay, the data is exactly stored as the domain expert explained it to us. In the property graph model, we have two basic concepts. First, the nodes. Nodes are the objects in the graph, so they are the entities, like I'm a node in a graph, sort of. It stores its data using name value properties, so for example, my first name, my last name, and my birthday, and I can have labels attached. So for example, when I, today here, I'm a speaker, I got a black button on it, so this is my label, I'm a speaker today. In this example, I'm an author, so it doesn't matter. Then we have relationships. Those relationships relate nodes by type, so they are also labeled or can be labeled. This example, it's a vote relationship, and it has a direction, so I wrote an article, which is not true, but it's an example, you know. And relationships can also store data using their value properties. So the same construct we have here can be here in this relationship. So we have really value in relationships. Comparing it to the relational model. So in our graph model, we have a node for me, nodes for the articles and the relationship. In the relationship model, relational model, we would have an table for the author, a join table, and an article, and here we have some foreign keys, here we have some primary keys, and here it's a bit more complex, and also when you think about writing a query, this will be much more complex than this. So the thing is, normally when we have a software system in place, it already uses a relational database. I think this is true for all of your projects, as well it is for most of the customer projects I am in currently. So the question is, when I made the decision to migrate to a graph database, how do I get there? How do I model the data so that I have the same data in place, but it is easier to access? I prepared an example, it's a CMS example I'm kind of proud. Maybe you say, as a CMS expert, okay, there's some missing things in there, or yeah, don't blame me. So we have our article, we have a tag, we have categories, person and author, which is our master data, and we have a comment, which is some kind of activity. So the domain model would look rather simple. We have a person, which can or is also labeled as author, which writes articles, which are contained in some categories, which can again be contained in categories. Articles can be tagged with, I don't know, technology or CMS or whatever. An article can have comments, and these comments are again written by a person. Not that hard. And I'm sure every domain expert will understand this simple graphic. When we have our relational database schema, it's a bit more complex. We see, okay, we have our article here, we have our comment and person and category and tag, but we also have our article tag to map the relationship between article and tag, and we have a table for the roles of person because a person can have multiple roles and we don't want to store it in a comma separated string. That's a bit creepy. What we see furthermore are some foreign keys. So for example, the comment stores a foreign key for the article to be referenced there. In the first step, when migrating from a relational database to a graph database, we have to migrate, we have to locate the foreign keys. So in this example, we have person ID for the role, article and person ID for the comment, because the comment is written by a person and written for an article. We have the parent category ID for the category and our two foreign keys for the article ID and tag ID. These foreign keys can be simply transferred to relationships. So what we see is a person has now a relationship, a directed relationship to a role. A comment is referenced from a person which wrote this article, and from an article which has the has comment label. There is some kind of a best practice when designing these relationships. Neo4j, especially in the native English countries, they prefer to have an active language in here, so that article has a comment, person wrote a comment, and not that we say comment is written by a person, so we want an active voice in here. Next step, we have to identify join tables. In this case, we only have the article tag, which has no further values in it, and these join tables also become relationships. If there would be some meta information on here, so for example, when it was tagged, then in this case, the has tag relationship would have such a name value pair to map it. So it's pretty easy. In the next step, we have to identify characteristics or specifiers, for example, the role. In this case, I'm a speaker. That's my role, and these can also be transformed. It's a bit difficult to draw it in such a diagram, so I tagged it up here. That's maybe not the best notation, but it was what Plant-UML gave me. And then we are done with transforming the data model, and it was, I guess, quite easy. There are two points I want to mention, especially regarding the schema design and migration. Neo4j, as a NoSQL database, as a graph database, has no schema in the classical sense. So the schema basically is defined by the data which is in there, but we don't define a schema for Neo4j where all data has to embed into. That's not the case. Thus, we also have no real schema migration. There is a tool called LiquidGraph, which is somehow a fork of LiquidBase, where they try to have some schema migration. For example, when I want to add relationships to specific nodes, then we can use this. But we don't have to migrate the schema itself, we have to migrate the data. Nevertheless, it is possible to define indexes on properties, and we have the ability to define uniqueness and existence constraints for properties. So that's what we can think of as schema design for Neo4j. It might feel weird a bit in the beginning when I did the last 10 years some kind of schema design for every sprint, that we now don't have to do it anymore, but we have to think about now how to migrate the data. Okay. So now we know how to model the data. How do we get data in there? So there's a basic Cypher-based load CSV capability. There's a command line bulk loader, JSON XML loaders. There is an ETL tool. This image is from the ETL tool. You can connect to a relational database. It scans for meta information to identify the schema and proposes a design for the data. You can update it afterwards. And there is NoSQL database access if you want to migrate MongoDB to Neo4j. Okay, what is important when we have data in there? How do we get data out? That's also pretty simple. We have our node, for example, the author, which wrote an article. And we have a basic notation. We have our match, which is like the select in SQL. We define our node. So we have a node with the label author, whose first name is Stefan. We want to match all nodes which are connected to another node by a vote relationship. And the other node must be an article, and we want to return all articles. So we get all articles which I wrote. Pretty easy. Same thing for finding all the authors. We have a match class for the author nodes, and we return the first name and the last name. And we get a table out of it. When we want to group, for example, the articles by the author, then we have to match our authors, persons I wrote here, which wrote an article, which is called A, and we return our first name, last name, and a collection of the title and published on date of the article. Maybe a bit more interesting is when we want to find all articles which are tagged as Neo4j. So remember the join table, so we have to select the first name and last name from table person, we have to join it to the article tag, and finally to the tag where the tag name is Neo4j. In Cypher it's much more short. We match our author who wrote an article which is tagged by a tag named Neo4j. That's it. We don't have left joins in here. We can use this easy query language, for example, to find co-occurring tags, so tags which occur on the same articles often, where we have tag T1 and a tag T2, which are linked to the same node, and we return our tag names and the number of co-occurrences. We can also use this to build a recommendation engine. I extended the data model for this special case to say, okay, a person commented on the article, will make our query a bit easier. And when we want to have our recommendation engine, we want to look at all articles which were written by, which were commented on by me. We take a look at what peer persons we have, so either those who wrote the article or commented on it, and we take a look at what articles are related to this peer person. And then we can say, okay, count the frequency, how often this occurred for one article, and we return it, and we have our recommendation engine. Pretty simple, but you get the idea. So I recommend to build a recommendation engine with graphs. That's pretty easy to do. For the closing of this talk, I prepared some special slides regarding CMS systems. I guess you deal often with hierarchical data. That's pretty easy to model, as we have seen. There is usage description, for example, for WordPress. I hope you don't kill me. For powerful recommendation engines, there is usage for page view tracking, for click path analysis using Snowplow. Structure, I don't know, you may know it. I didn't know it before, but it's the most used graph-based CMS system in the world. It's also using Neo4j or Graph CMS, which is using GraphQL and below Neo4j. So that's it for my introduction. I guess I'm a bit over time. If you have any questions, please come back to me in the break and have fun. Thank you.